Okay, well, we have a stop the presses moment. So OpenAI CEO founder Sam Altman did an over 40-minute interview the other day with a reporter from TechCrunch, and man, did he talk about a lot, and he answered a lot of questions about what you want to know to what's coming to ChatGPT, when does GPT-4 come out, competitors like Google, and how governments get their heads around AI. So I'm going to break down the 14 highlights from his interview and give a little bit of my thoughts on each of them. Let's go. Okay, number one, the unexpected progress of AI. Everybody thought AI was coming from the low-level work first, and then it was going to work its way up to doctors, lawyers, developers, and creatives. Well, it turns out, and Sam gave his thoughts on this as well, it's actually happening in the opposite direction. Turns out AI, the robotics to do the manual labor, aren't as good as the actual intellect part that's coming out of ChatGPT. So who's it coming for first? The creatives, and even things like lawyers and doctors, it can do some of that stuff better, certainly not all of it, today through the chat prompt. So things are going in the opposite direction. It's not the low-skill labor. It's the high-skill people who need to watch out first. Scary. Okay, number two, the current impact ChatGPT is having on the world, particularly in education. Teachers are freaking out because students can write papers, do homework, and it's not clear if they're using AI to do it. So Sam talked about this, and basically what he said is, it is his view and his company's view that they dole this technology out a little bit at a time where it's relatively low stakes. Some students cheat for a few years, schools have to adjust, versus sitting on for the next 2 or 3 years and then unleashing something like artificial general intelligence that will blow the world's minds. It's his view, you do it a little bit at a time, let education and certain sectors deal with it as it comes out, while it's still very imperfect and error-prone and relatively easy to spot. There's also tools for those businesses and schools to kind of identify things that were created by chatbots. They're talking about putting watermarks in these signatures so people can see it, but it's his view to dole this stuff out a little bit at a time so society can get its head around it. Because if they do it all at once, we're not going to be ready for it, and we're going to be too blindsided. Oh yeah, the one everyone's been waiting for, the release of GPT-4, the technology that everyone thinks is going to completely blow us away. Sam said, hold up, it's coming. He won't say when. When they're ready, basically. What does that mean? If you read between the lines, it sounds like probably sometime this year. They're testing it. It's good. But it's not ready yet, and they don't want to unleash this on the world for the same reasons you heard a minute ago, because if people aren't ready for it and it's not perfect, it's going to cause chaos. So it's coming. When? TBD. My bet's on sometime in mid to late 2023. Okay, number four, the expectations for GPT-4. He said, in no uncertain terms, everybody is going to be disappointed. So what does that mean? Because of this early success of ChatGPT, expectations have gotten way out of whack. And a lot of people now think that this next thing that comes is going to be artificial general intelligence, truly machines that can learn on their own effectively without an algorithm to tell them where to go. That is not the case. GPT-4 will be better. It will be impressive. And I'm sure he's sandbagging a little bit. But he expects everyone to be disappointed. The hype has gotten so far, it's like, you know, one of those movies that's supposed to be great, and then it comes out and it gets like a 70 on Rotten Tomatoes. That's what we're probably looking at for GPT-4, unless, again, Sam is entirely sandbagging us. But maybe just pour a little cold water on thinking that, I don't know, like GPT-4 is going to go to the store, get your groceries, come back, and snuggle with you in bed. We're not there yet. On the variation of AI, so what does that mean? A lot of people are concerned if there is one or two dominant companies like OpenAI and Microsoft and then Google who control the substrate of all AI that is out there because it requires such computing power that there's going to be a sameness in thought, a sameness in value. And what Sam said is, in his idea, a perfect world, and again, this is the CEO of the leading company, there will be many of them out there and they can be tailored to your individual preferences. He sees a world where people can sit down with their personal AI and say, hey, these are my values. This is the sort of output I want. This is my level of sensitivity. And then you could train the AI to be in your likeness rather than the likeness of big companies like Google and Microsoft, because we've all seen the problems that can occur when big tech and big corporations or even big governments get to dictate the way people think and feel. That's not going to work with AI, in Sam's opinion, and he thinks everybody should be able to train their own, which is kind of frightening, but also interesting, I guess. We're getting very close to the movie Her here, folks. When is ChatGPT going to be integrated into Microsoft Office, as has been reported? I'm just going to read you Sam's quote here because it's kind of ridiculous and a little bit arrogant. He said to the reporter, "You are a very experienced and professional reporter. You know I can't comment on that. I know you know I can't comment on that. You know you know I can't comment on that. In the spirit of shortness of life and our precious time here, why do you ask?" Sam has this unbelievable way of looking at someone with the most disdain, deadpan, dare I say, robotic look. So kind of a cold answer here, but he is not giving us anything about Microsoft's plans on when ChatGPT is coming to Office, but it's probably going to be this year. This is a big one on Google and their potential AI. Pretty clear they're building one. And Sam basically said, listen, you have a lot of smart people at Google. I'm confident they're going to do something that is very impressive. Let's not sell them short just because they weren't the first people to market. But what's more interesting, as he said, is AI is not coming for search just yet. Sure, it's going to impact the way that we think about getting information. But as I've talked about in earlier videos, what AI is really good at is generative output, helping you create works. So sure, you can ask it basic facts, which today it's getting wrong a little bit. Google's still better at that stuff. Where AI is really good is helping you to create something, creating alongside of you, you giving it inputs to get an output. And that's basically what Altman said. He's like, listen, Google search is not going to change. It's a big business. Search is a big business. Google's good at it, and there's still a huge use for it. So don't expect just because we have better AI coming that the game of searching on the internet's going away anytime soon. The founder of the company that's going to bring it to Google the most doesn't think that's the case, and you should probably stop talking about how Google's dead because you sound like an idiot. Okay, next, how teachers and others can get around and detect AI. So put yourself in the shoes of a 12th grade teacher who assigns out a research paper and gets something back. How does she know whether that's been written by a bot? Sure, today there are tools like QuillBot that can detect plagiarism. ChatGPT is thinking about putting watermarks in so it'll be easy to spot. But what Sam said was like, basically, don't go counting on this. When governments think about regulation, how you can identify content created by an AI, don't just rely on these systems that are going to be built in, because he said a very determined person is always going to be a step ahead and get around that stuff. And there are ways to massage and edit the output in a way that it's not clear it was made by a robot, even if 80, 90, 95% of it was. So basically his message was, hey, listen, we're going to try and give people tools, but there's always going to be ways around it. And whenever you do, governments, institutions, don't craft your rules, your laws, around the assumption that we are going to give you the tools to detect it, because they're not always going to work. Kind of scary, but you know, here we are. Okay, next, on when video is coming out. So we've all seen what AI could do with images and with text, and there's some apps here and there that could do like very light video, but it's coming. And he said it's a very real research project within OpenAI. They're working on it. Other companies are working on it. This is coming. He wouldn't say when, but he confirmed like it's going to happen and likely soon. The pace of innovation right now, to me, makes it feel like this is a late 2023, early 2024 thing where we begin to see video AI that could put out like video that can trick someone into thinking they're watching something that is truly real. That technology exists at like an enterprise level right now, but the consumer use case like ChatGPT did for written text is probably coming, I'd say, in about the next 9 to 12 months. He wouldn't say when. This is where we're gonna have the most problem as a society. It's one thing to create written text that can be faked, but it's another thing when you have someone's image and voice and words all sounding, looking, and feeling like the actual person. Think about when you have the president of a country declare war or say something crazy. It's going to be very, very difficult for society to be able to detect these things and put in the necessary safeguards. This is probably the scariest technology for the impact on how people think, because it, once the cat is out of the bag, it doesn't go back. Okay, on the best case scenario for AI. So he was kind of vague on this, but he basically said he tries to think in terms of years, not decades, what can happen next year versus 70,000 years from now. And he said the pace of progress is going to be staggering in just years. So that's kind of an alarming statement. And when you think about video coming and maybe artificial general intelligence, which he said is we're getting there. And there's not going to be a moment where you're like, oh my God, this is a standalone, sentient, smart machine. However, it's closer than we think. And as we get closer, it becomes less and less clear when that moment happens. In his view, it's not a binary moment that we have artificial general intelligence. It's kind of like will gradually happen. And at some point, we're going to turn around and look back and say, oh yeah, that was the year where this sort of took over. But the quote I do want to read for you at the very end of this, to me, was really telling. He said, I think the good case is just so unbelievably good that you sound like a really crazy person to start talking about it. Okay, on the worst case, I'm just going to read this because I don't want to mix his words up here. Worst case scenario, the bad case, and I think this is like important to say, is like lights out for all of us. I'm more worried about an accidental misuse case in the short term where you know someone gets super powerful. It's not like the AI wakes up and decides to be evil. And I think all of the sort of traditional AI safety thinkers reveal a lot more about themselves than they mean to when they talk about what they think the AGI is going to be like. So basically, don't worry so much about the AI like organizing all the robots and killing everybody. Worry about the technology getting into the wrong hands, the wrong government, and using it for evil. That's what we have to worry about in the short term. And he views it as an existential threat if it happens. Next up, on when artificial general intelligence will be here, we kind of already went over this one. Basically, he said is like, it's coming sooner than we think, but there's not going to be a specific moment where we could say, it's here. It's going to be gradual. It will begin to be mixed into all of these technology platforms. And at some point, we're going to look back and say, oh, wow, like this thing kind of thinks on its own. On what he uses ChatGPT for. So basically, he said he doesn't create emails with it. Their interviewer said, hey, when I got your email, was that a bot? And he's like, no, but he does use it to summarize long emails. He said it's really great at summarizing. And to be honest, that's what we've used it here for at Smoking Robot. When we see a long article, we want to kind of get to the point. We've even used it for some of our newsletters to give us bullet point summaries. It's really good at taking a block of text you give it and distilling it down. He said he also uses it for translation and honestly, just to learn and ask it things. Interesting. And lastly, he talked about the impact AI is going to have on AI startups. So as I've talked about in other videos, a lot of the tools, particularly the writing tools, are basically just a layer on top of ChatGPT. So you could give a prompt to get a press release or a blog post in ChatGPT, but you need to know what to say. And there's lots of people out there putting out tutorials and guides on how to get the most out of it. And then there are companies that are just creating apps on top of the API and giving you fields to put your title or your subject or what topic you want. And then they're feeding that into the exact same API and giving you like a cleaner output. It's a layer of user interface. But once OpenAI figures out how to do this itself and put the technology inside, I don't know, like Microsoft Office, a lot of these apps are going to go away. And the question to him was like, hey, are you going to put all these like little developers out of business? And his answer was no. At the end of the day, they really want to be an API company. Sure, they're going to create their own tools to show people what the technology could be. But they view themselves, I think, as more of like an Amazon Web Services that powers the AI internet versus like the Apple that creates the consumer-facing product of that. So I guess that's a kind of bullish case for a lot of these apps that are building on top of it. Doesn't seem like they want to Sherlock all of their features. They actually want to give them the tools and empower them to do more. He also said this is the best time to be a creator, to start a business. That happens in a recession. And, you know, people are like, well, why? He's like, sure, it's harder to raise capital, but it's easier to hire people. More people don't have multiple job offers. Cost of acquiring customers goes down because you're not competing against so many other people in the advertising space. So like there's a lot of good businesses to be built out of this. And he compared it to the start of the App Store back in 2008. He said, I think we're at one of those moments for the tools, products, services, and companies that are going to be built on the backs of AI. All right, so that was 14 highlights of Sam Altman's interview with TechCrunch. If you found this even remotely interesting, like even just a little bit, like one of the 14 was like, yeah, Kyle, like I got something from that. Give us a like. If you like two or more, give us a subscribe. We're going to have these videos every single day, the latest news in AI tools, and make sure you check out our site, smokingrobot.ai. You can sign up for our newsletter Monday, Wednesday, Friday each week. We'll give you news, distilled down so normal humans can understand it, nothing too complicated. We'll give you a new tool every day, a cool app, a cool developer, a cool, you know, something out there to help you get your job done more efficiently. So go to smokingrobot.ai, subscribe to our newsletter. We have over 340 AI tools and apps with more coming, chronicled, sortable by category on the website. So you can check out all those. We have links. There's some discounts. Make sure to leave a comment. Let us know what you want us to make a video about next. And thanks for watching.